in places, as I've mentioned, one where the police, the federation, individual officers, health service, etc., they all have their own very senior representation, and there's essentially no equality of arms for families in these circumstances. The idea that the coroner can represent the interests of the family is just a fiction. The coroners and many others said that this is not possible to do so in many respects. It suggests that the coroner is not impartial. And the families, no matter how intelligent or how able they are consumed with grief and suffering, and they cannot represent themselves and should not ever be expected to represent themselves in the context of these very complex and very difficult legal hearings. And therefore it's very important that they have this legal advice from the very beginning and through the inquest to ensure that they are properly represented and that their participation is that which is required under Article 2 of the European Convention, in other words, material and effective. The coroner's system itself does not allow coroners to, in this context, really have the inquisitorial role that they are given. They therefore are dependent on the other agencies to carry out the investigation. Coroners are employed by local authorities. Some of them indeed have in their back office seconded police officers or civilians, and therefore they are not in a position, because of the grace and favour relationship which they have very often with local authorities, to actually secure the expert evidence they require or indeed embark on a fulsome investigation without reliance on the IPCC, the CPS or other agencies. And that's a very, very significant weakness. And it's one which means that it's only at the hearing itself that the coroner can actually begin the inquiry properly. He may have the ability to make requests for these agencies to carry out certain information, but has had in the past the power to direct any of his agencies to ensure that that information which the coroner considers to be relevant is brought to the fore and indeed funded. And therefore there needs to be a look at the system. The Shipman Inquiry recommended there should be a National Coroner's Service. I also recommend that. I think it's very important that the Coroner's Service is supported and is as professional and expert in these issues as it possibly can be. And coroners simply at the moment are overwhelmed and do not have resources. As a result of that, again, there is an imbalance in terms of the resources. Even at inquests, we heard of evidence of the coroner's asking the IPCC to carry out the photocopying for disclosure purposes because they don't have basic resources which are available to them. So that's very important. If this system is going to be one which is thorough, is meaningful and achieves its objectives, it has to be properly resourced, properly organised. There must be much greater coordination and early consultation among the agencies who are involved in that process. I suggest that there should be no conferral and recommend there should be no conferral by police officers after the death. At the moment there is a process where police officers may come together following an unexpected death in these circumstances, and they will be placed together in a room under supervision. I spoke to the Police Federation during the review, and it was explained to me that while there was no discussion about beliefs as to what had happened or opinions as to what had happened, such conferrals are used in order to ensure that there is that people's memories are jogged. And that in itself, in other circumstances, would be a very sinister development. It is absolutely critical that the evidence of police officers in these circumstances is an honest and individual recollection of what they remember happening, and not in any way inadvertently or indeed deliberately influenced by the evidence of another person who's there. That's not something which is separate or distinct from what we're asking for. Civilian witnesses. Civilian witnesses are routinely separated in order to ensure there's no contamination of their evidence, and indeed it is important that the same applies to police officers. It is also important for police officers, because if a police officer or a number of police officers have identical statements from each other, as a QC, if I was representing someone on the other side, if we characterise it, I will be cross-examining them on the reality of that and the fact that people do not see things identically, that discrepancies are natural. The explanation given to me by the Federation was that the IPCC and the CPS are very hard and very challenging where there are discrepancies in statements, and that motivates this type of conferral. Well, that culture has to stop. There has to be a recognition that people are imperfect, recollections may be imperfect, but we want their honest and best recollection. There also needs to be a duty on police officers to provide statements in these circumstances as early as possible. I heard evidence of police officers taking months to produce a statement, and that's simply not good enough. Police officers as public servants, unless they are suspects, in which case they enjoy the same rights of silence as any other. However, up until that point, police officers should be obliged to ensure that statements are provided briskly and in a manner which is candid and intended to secure a full and objective assessment of the evidence from their own recollection of events. That's not to say that people with an intent on perverting the course of justice can't get together over the phone, at night, or whatever, but for the state to condone this by having such conferral meetings taking place is in itself, I think, a matter of real concern. Family's effort that I spoke to during this, as well as police officers, and in particular police officers from the Federation, emphasised the importance of learning from these deaths. Most families are not motivated out of any sense of revenge, but for justice, and to ensure that other families do not have to go through this horrendous process ever again. And to that end, learning and sustained learning from this is very important. There is an abundance of reports on commissions such as my own that have taken place over a number of years, and many of my recommendations are reflected in those, but they haven't actually seen their way to the coalface, not actually happening out there. And while there are many very impressive training packages available from the College of Policing, many of these are not being implemented in practice, and that is what's important, is that we look at how we can sustain learning in the future, how we can ensure that the reports of coroners are disseminated across the country and are made known and responded to in a way which makes them accountable. And therefore there needs to be a mechanism in this country to ensure that these recommendations and reports of coroners are taken forward. And there is at the moment a vacuum there, and I make a recommendation for an office that it's accountable to Parliament to be a mechanism for ensuring that police officers or chief police officers, when they may respond to the coroner's recommendations in the reports or prevention of death reports, are thereafter followed up, that someone's looking to see, is it happening at the moment? The inspectorates can do that, but they do it thematically very often and too late. We need to ensure that changes are happening on the ground and are happening rapidly and quickly. So those are, that's a summary of some of the aspects of the report. The most significant is a recognition that we have so many people suffering from mental health going into our police stations and being arrested and kept under custody. Many people who are dangerously intoxicated, and however obnoxious someone may be if they're heavily intoxicated, they are also in a position of a threat of death. And therefore we have to have a system that's able to cope with that. It's no surprise to anybody. We have to ensure that young, vulnerable people are not going into police stations, and I'm delighted to see that the government's response is that those under 18 should not be taken to a station as a place of safety. A police station is not a place of safety for anyone suffering from mental health or indeed from a significant illness. The absence of the NHS in police stations, we have some of the most frail and ill people in this country, is a matter of concern, because if I'm very drunk, and I'm also diabetic or I have epilepsy, I may not give a coherent account to the police surgeon or the forensic practitioner who comes in. There needs to be access to my medical records, there needs to be a history known to the police before I'm left in a cell on my own in what appears to be a deep sleep. And having CCTV cameras will not address that. We need to have much greater medical care within our police stations, and we have to have far fewer of those who are there going into police stations. I'm delighted to see that far fewer are going in, and the numbers have reduced, and I think that we have to commend the police and the government for that. But there are still some very, very vulnerable people going into police stations. There's nothing safe about a police station for someone suffering from mental ill health. It is the last place that someone should be, and we need to recognise that. We need to make sure that we take steps to address it. In the 21st century, we are not putting people who are ill but who are obstreperous and noisy and perhaps violent into circumstances which are not going to address the very fundamental needs that they and their families require from them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anish. I know there are press here who'd like to ask questions and indeed do one-to-one interviews, but I'm just going to give a couple of minutes to the families just on the platform just to say a couple of words about the report. I don't know who would like to start, but Tony, if you'd like to.
I think the campaigning work that I've been doing since my son James died just over 7 years ago has been for moments like this. I kind of said to Eva Shangeloni at the first time I met her with other families that I was rapidly coming to the conclusion the state actually wasn't really interested in stopping killing people because there'd been no change at all to the fact there were no successful prosecutions, that whilst the numbers have reduced a bit, we've gone through a process which was slow, it was full of delay, we struggled to get any kind of legal funding, and were it not for inquest support, we'd have gone stark raving mad with frustration. The fact that Elis Angelini, who's excelled in public life and actually comes from a fairly sort of ordinary tough Glaswegian background is on the case, rather than some kind of, you know, civil servant with less balls, excuse my vernacular, made me actually feel perhaps something's going to happen, something will really happen. And I've been lucky enough personally to have recently the IPCC produce a good bit of work about my son's death, and seeing this, and it is a recommendation-rich report, all of which I thoroughly agree with. As I said, it's this sort of moment that I've been waiting for. Now, can the government please now implement it and not sit on it, not kind of do what they've done, which is nothing about it. I've read the government response briefly today, and it looks a bit like yes, minister, to me. But there again, I'm terribly inexperienced at these sorts of things. But I want to say, from my point of view, thank you very much.